Now, there was another whole set of things which was blocking us from God. It wasn't just our defects of character and our insanities, but it was also all this guilt we were carrying around. And that's why we have to, in our fourth step, we have to find out whom we've harmed and become willing right then to set matters straight if we can. In our fifth step, we're going to admit what we have done. And in the sixth and seventh step, we're seeking relief from our defects. In the eighth and ninth steps, we're seeking relief from our guilts. Because keep in mind that our guilts block us from God just as surely as do our defects and our insanities. And so the eighth step turns out to be, by the time we get there, it's mostly already done because we did it when we took our fourth step. It is quite clear that we cannot make an amends in our ninth step if someone else is going to be harmed, certainly not without their permission. And this cuts really right across the board with all the amends that we need to make. An example would be, suppose that we need to make amends to a family that we have hurt deeply over a long period of years. It would be a terrible mistake to go to them and sit them down for 3 hours with a parade of the horribles, making them relive every rotten, nasty, stinking, dirty thing we ever did. That would be a terrible mistake. And so we keep it short, we keep it to the point. And we recognize that with family, we may have to be making amends for the rest of their lives, or the rest of our life, by not only by living a sober way of life, but by being the kind of person, family member, that will be an addition to the family and a strength and a spiritual guide to the family, an inspiration. In marital matters, or in matters where we have perhaps have cheated on a spouse or a loved one, there are many times when we are not permitted to make this amends, to just jump up and give the names of the other party and talk about how wonderful it was, but we're really sorry anyway and all that stuff. Usually that's very bad to do, because the big book says jealousy is the most terrible human emotion, plus the fact that that third party is very likely to catch the brunt of the anger and the jealousy, and we don't have any right to do that. There are other instances where we are forbidden to make amends. For example, where we have committed a criminal act, and we know we've never been caught, never been charged, nobody's looking for us, but we did it anyway. Now we've got a whole new family, we've got a new way of life, we've got people who count on us. We would, in order for us to be shriven of our guilt, our inclination is to want to be, the big book calls a martyr, and run and say, here I am, you know, incarcerate me. And that might be okay in some instances, but if we have people who are counting upon us, who need us, who will be seriously harmed by our incarceration or even prolonged time in trial, we have to go to them first and tell them frankly what happened and ask their permission before we do that. We may have to just live with it. A lot of times there are amends that we cannot make. Another thing that we remember and we make sure that we teach our sponsees is that there is no such thing as going into amends expecting or seeking forgiveness. That's not the point at all. The point of making amends is to be freed from the guilt which is blocking us from God. And therefore, our approach is not begging for forgiveness, but forthright admission of the things which we have done and a demonstration of how sorry we are about it and our willingness to set matters straight if we can. And so we are not permitted to harm somebody else in our making our amends. Big Book says we clean off our side of the street, which means simply this: if I'm making amends to you and you were equally harmful to me, or maybe the scales are way tilted on your side, I'm still not permitted to bring that up. I don't criticize you. I don't excuse myself based upon what you have done. I simply talk about what I've done, express how sorry I am for it, and ask if there's something I can do to be helpful. And so there are these rules that must be followed. And that rule that we cannot do anything to harm another person is a set rule. It cuts all the way through our lives and everything that we do. There's a corollary, by the way, which most people don't understand or are not taught, that we're not permitted to allow another person to harm us. That's also a spiritual rule. Why? Because when we're being harmed, we're being blocked from God. What's the whole point of all this? Therefore, if someone is harming us, we say, stop right there. We'll have none of this. And if you can't get it stopped, you got to get away. We do not permit another person to harm us ever again. Everybody in this room at one time or another was a victim. If you stop and think about it, you'll realize that in order to get your own way, decisions based on self rationalized for you that it was okay to be a victim, to let others get away with it, to take their abuse in order to get what you wanted, to be part of the gang, to be accepted. Some victimization is very subtle, others is very overt, but nevertheless, we have all compromised and we've settled. We're not going to do that anymore. And so now it says that we're going to have to stay close to God and perform His work well. That means 10, 11, and 12. Those are the steps which we're going to use for the rest of our lives to stay close to God and perform His work well. In the process, we will continue to grow spiritually, which we must do. There's no sitting still, ever. We will become disciplined and consistent. We will do what we are supposed to do every day. We will recognize that spirituality is a daily process, not something we can put in a bank and save up for a rainy day. That our program today doesn't do a thing for us tomorrow. That every day is a day when we must surrender as we go through the day. We're going to surrender in prayer. We're going to surrender in meditation. We're going to surrender by virtue of our being willing to help others, turning our thoughts to others we can help. That's why the Big Book says that every day is a day when we must carry a vision of God's will for us into all our activities, and that all we have is a daily reprieve. That's it. But it's a miracle that we have that. This deadly, incurable progressive illness has been placed in full, complete, absolute remission. And now we have the tools, the 10th, 11th, and 12th steps to keep it there, if we but use them. And this is where everybody starts to fall apart. You see, the 10th step came about because our founders realized through hard experience that they were not perfect, that the world and all of its people would continue to threaten them, that threat equals fear, and fear equals the recurrence, the reoccurrence, the reappearance of defects. So they found they had to have a way to keep up with this. And the 10th step came about as a result of that. The 10th step you'll find on page 84. This thought brings us to step 10, which suggests we continue to take personal inventory. Now, an inventory is a written